They left the cramped, crowded cities of the North at the turn of the century and migrated south. Jewish immigrants, peddlers mostly, who saved their money and then opened stores. By the 1930s, these Jews and their children formed the backbone of the merchant class in hundreds of small southern towns. But the next generation of young Jews didn't stay. Instead, they headed back to the big cities. Today, the exodus is nearly complete, and only scattered remnants of a once thriving culture remain. Greenwood, Mississippi, is home to the last remaining Orthodox congregation in the state, one of the last small towns where you can still hear Hebrew prayers with a drawl.
The city of Greenwood, on the banks of the Yazoo River, sits right in the middle of the Mississippi Delta. The old downtown is filled with worn one- and two-story red brick buildings, most put up just after the turn of the century, when Greenwood was the nation's cotton capital, a bustling port city. Today, all that's left of that era are faded painted signs on the sides of some of these buildings, advertisements for general stores and cigar shops and nickel cokes. Many of these businesses had names not readily associated with the Deep South.
This building on this corner used to be Klein and Blumenthal's department store. The sign's still on the building. You can see it.
This is Joe Erber, postman and one of the last remaining Jews of Greenwood, Mississippi.
This building we're going into now to deliver mail used to be Gilman's Cafe. It belonged to my uncle. See? Hey, this morning.
It's turning a little cold, isn't it?
It sure is. We're going to snow tonight, they say.
Joe Erber is a sight in his untucked postal blues with his long handlebar mustache. At 6'2", weighing nearly 300 pounds, Joe looks more like a linebacker than the town's rabbi, but he is. Along with his duties as a full-time postman and part-time policeman, Joe is the spiritual leader of Congregation Ahavath Reim, which roughly translates brotherly love.
Where you been?
While certainly not an area of the country normally associated with Judaism, small southern towns from El Dorado, Arkansas to Lockport, Louisiana were once home to sizable communities of Jews. While Jews first began trickling into the Deep South as early as the 1700s, the bulk arrived around the turn of the century, Eastern European immigrants seeking relief from tenement life in New York and other northern cities. Most came as peddlers, eventually opening dozens of shops up and down the main streets of these towns.
At one time, the store next door to this one was Jewish. The store up the street was Jewish. On down the street was Jewish laundry. On down the street was a five and dime store Jewish. There was Bennett's Bargain Store. Across the street, there was a kosher butcher, a kosher tailor. There were two or three ready-to-wear stores and some of the biggest stores in town still, if you look up on the walls, you see Jewish.
The tracks of the C&G Railroad run down the middle of Johnson Street in Greenwood. It's here that you'll find one of only two Jewish stores that remain in town today. Kornfeld's is an old-fashioned dry goods store, dealing mostly in clothing and shoes.
We were here when the streets were mud and dirt. We've been here a long time.
Leslie Kornfeld is 79 years old and owns this store, which his father, Wolf, started. No one is exactly sure when. Leslie Kornfeld is tall, thin, and nearly bald, dapperly dressed with a little accounts notebook in his breast pocket. Kornfeld was born and raised in Greenwood, bar mitzvahed at Congregation Ahavath Reim. He says that growing up a Southern Jew was not so bad.
I had fights. I was called Christ killer. I told him what the hell I knew had to do with killing Christ. I had nothing to do with killing Christ. But when I got in high school, I was son on a basketball team. I made the track team, and we got along fine. They looked at me and they said, well, he's a human being after all, maybe.
But I think it was a lot different when I was coming up than when you were coming up.
Leslie Kornfeld's son, Bubba, has wandered to the back of the store where we're talking.
Because there were a lot more Yehudim here when you were coming up. Yeah. When I was coming up, there were like four or five of us. I mean, I'll be honest with you, I had a hell of a time coming up. There were people that wouldn't have anything to do with me because of who I was and what I was, and because my hair was kinky instead of straight, and my name began with Korn instead of Smith or Jones. I know that.
Bubba Kornfeld is the only one of Leslie Kornfeld's children to remain in Greenwood. The other two moved on, one to Chattanooga, the other to Memphis. Like his father before him, Leslie Kornfeld is the president of Congregation Ahavoth Reim. But unlike his father, he has had to witness the demise of Greenwood's once thriving Jewish community and watch his congregation wither away to next to nothing. It was a process set into motion in the late 1940s in the Delta with the arrival of the mechanized cotton picker, which drove huge numbers of field hands north and caused small businesses to suffer. By the 1960s, Jewish migration was in full swing.
The older people died out. The young people went to college, got the degrees, the lawyers, doctors. They didn't want to go back to the little towns. It was no nice. You take a town with 1,500 people, 1,000 or 3,000, these little communities around here. There was nothing there for them. So they went either to Memphis, or New Orleans, or Birmingham, different to the city. And they left us old folks here to ponder what the future and dream about the past.
A past in which Ahavoth Reim would have standing room only crowds at the synagogue. Now it's almost impossible to pull together a minyan on Friday nights, the minimum 10 men required by Jewish law to conduct services. A past when Ahavoth Reim Sunday School supported several hundred children. Today there are only 4 young Jewish people left in town. Most congregants are in their 70s or older.
We're trying to keep going, it's all we can do. Because after all, we're 12 people. I don't even know if we got 12 people left because we lost. In the past year, we've lost 2 members, 3 members. It's really a pitiful situation. It's not going to get no better. It's going to get worse. If we lose any more members, what do you got? But we keep plugging along.
On most Friday afternoons, after he's done delivering the mail, Joe Erber sheds his postal uniform in favor of police sergeant stripes. Joe has been an auxiliary policeman in Greenwood for the past 12 years.
Okay, son, you're under arrest.
And at about 7:45 in the evening, Joe Erber calls in 10-6, or busy, to his dispatcher, so he can begin making his way over to Ahavoth Reim to lead services. The synagogue sits just on the outskirts of downtown Greenwood. It's a good-sized red brick building with white pillars out front. Most members of the congregation begin arriving a few minutes before services and gather together in the vestibule. The last to show up is Joe Erber. He is not an ordained rabbi, but ever since 1968, when Ahavoth Reim could no longer support its full-time rabbi, a congregant has had to lead the services. Erber, as usual, arrives a little out of breath in his police uniform, a walkie-talkie and a billy club on one hip, a .357 Magnum on the other. But even the president of the congregation doesn't seem to mind.
He keeps us all quiet.
I asked a rabbi about that, and he says the soldiers in Israel carry guns, and they daven, and they pray, and it's perfectly all right in America, too.
The congregants begin making their way into the sanctuary, which is stunning, old but immaculately kept up, with high-arched ceilings, dark wood and stained glass all around. They pull prayer books off a shelf at the back of the synagogue. The men take tattered prayer shawls off a wooden rack, kiss them, and drape them over their shoulders. Joe Erber walks to the front of the synagogue and steps up onto the pulpit. This room, he says, brings back a lifetime of memories.
I can close my eyes. My father wore hearing aid glasses. He had hearing aid in both ears. And we used to have a rabbi that reminded me of a Baptist preacher when he talked his sermons. He would rant and rave and pound the pulpit and to get his points across. And when he got up and it came part of the time for the sermon, my father would reach up and you would hear click, click as he hit both hearing aid switches. And he would sit there with the prettiest smile on his face and his eyes closed. And pretty soon he'd start snoring. And I could see that just like, you know, it was yesterday.
Joe Joe Erber stands with his back to the congregation, facing the simple mahogany ark which holds the Torahs. It is a rather unforgettable sight, this hulking good old boy, handlebar mustache, pistol and all, gently rocking back and forth, his eyes closed, the tassels of his prayer shawl brushing the podium. Behind him, the curved wooden pews are mostly empty. The congregants have spread out comfortably in the last three rows on one side of the temple. There are nearly 20 people here tonight. It's the largest crowd they've had in months. With myself included, they have a minion for the first time since the high holidays.
Morning, Kaddish.
Amen.
There are worries that for next year's high holidays, the most sacred holy days in the Jewish religion, the congregation will not be able to pull together a minion. In Meridian, Mississippi, Orthodox congregation Othel Jacob had resorted to taking out ads in Jewish newspapers, offering to pay males to come to Meridian for their services. But it didn't work. Othel Jacob closed its doors this past spring, leaving Ahavath Reim as the only remaining Orthodox congregation in the state, and as one of the last holdouts in a chapter of Jewish history which seems destined soon to end.
I can see the handwriting on the wall. You know, it's just not going to be. Eventually, this is going to fall the way of all other little synagogues and temples in the state. I can take you to Canton, Mississippi right now and show you where they had a fine temple. The only thing left is looking like a gravestone. Said this marks the spot of the temple so-and-so. And that's what it is, a gravestone for a congregation. And eventually, I think that's what we're going to have.
Adonai Yemlech Lelavoyin V'Nemah
Yehoyadonai. One of the younger members, younger than I am, he and I have a saying every time we go to a funeral for another one of the olders. The last one out, please close the gate. You know, last one out, close the gate. You ready?
Yeah.
She and I used to do the horse.
I'm ready.
You ready?